All right, what's up, guys? Welcome to the 68th episode of The Get Down. My name is Kareem.
Gary W. here.
We're going to rush one out today, guys. Just warning you ahead of time. We got the Get Down holiday party. Yeah, we have a team outing today. We're all going to the New Jersey Devils hockey game. There's about 35 of us going. Should be a complete shit show.
Can't even believe we have that many guys going out, but it's going to be a really good time. Some guys we haven't really been, or I haven't been acquainted with yet because, you know, I'm not always here. Though recently I have been for the last 6 weeks, I feel. That's going to be.
How many times tonight are you and I going to whisper to each other, wait, yo, who is that? Because we're assholes and we're the worst.
I want to know how many times, right? I'm going to be like, well, I met him at 5:30. Now what's his name? It's 7:30. terrible with names. Well, I was saying this the other day.
Yeah. We invited our core team. We invited some of the guys that and girls that we use a decent amount. And then we invited kind of like the group of guys and girls who occasionally will get bookings and kind of just help us out here and there. And we don't know a lot of those people. So it should be good. We haven't had a Get Down meetup in a while. So this is going to be like a mini Get Down meetup, which I'm excited for.
I'm really excited about it. I can't wait to get over there and see everybody. We're hanging out at Reds before across from the Prudential Center. That's going to be fun. They did a good job last time we were out there. It was good.
Yeah.
And the game just in general was an awesome time. So we did this, what? Was this 3 years ago now? It had to have been.
Could be.
It had
2019.
I believe.
Jeez.
Yeah. So it's been a while. We're going to be a bunch of geeks and get our picture on the ice afterward.
Big shout to TJ, the DJ, who is the Devils home game DJ. We'll probably go show him some love. I'm sure he's going to show us some love also. So that'll be fun. But
yeah, it's going to be a good time.
So we wanted to start up this episode with a little follow-up to the drama that unfolded last week with the DJ producer Funk D, I guess no longer allegedly stealing one of my edits, but stealing one of my edits and coming to find out that not only did they take the person he hired take my edit, but also took about four other edits that were on the Get Down edit pack. And probably his entire edit pack was just songs that were stolen and renamed.
Yeah. That might be whoever he hired, maybe they think like, Oh, this is like a small time edit pack. Nobody's ever going to see this. But you know, the DJ community is decently small worldwide at this point because like everybody in the edit community knows each other from Australia to New York City to Boston, all the way to LA. It's like you can't get away with that stuff this day and age because music is shared across so many different platforms, and you know, whether it be SoundCloud or MixCloud or record pools such as HMC and DMP. It's so accessible to everyone. Word's going to get back to the person who made that track if you're stealing stuff. But, talk a little bit about the follow-up, like the immediate kickback once we put the podcast out.
So last week we recorded and I had sent a message to Funk D and said, hey man, I'm pretty sure that, you know, one of your edits on your newest pack is literally an edit that was mine that you just slapped your name on. And, you know, there were some other DJs, Patsy and Olive Oil had reached out because there was another edit that they had done that they were having some communication back and forth with Funk D. And basically what he told me and told them was, hey, I met some dude while I was on tour. I was in South America. He opened for me at a show and we talked about me hiring him to do edit packs for me. He's like, I'm touring. I don't have a lot of time. And I want to get the content out and I just wanted to hire somebody. So he hired this dude from South America who then went on to just steal all these edits and slap Funk D's name on and put the pack out that way. He paid this guy also. So like, he also was sending me the message that he sent this other DJ and the guy wasn't answering at first and then finally answered and like apologized or whatever and admitted that he did it. So like, we kind of have the proof that it did happen. And you know, like we talked about last week, it's not a good look and you got to kind of be on top of this stuff, but you know, he actually listened to the podcast and he's like, dude, I appreciate you guys for not like number one, just destroying me But number two, like, you brought up some really good points. And, you know, when I'm in New York, I would love to come on the show. So I think we're going to try and get him on the show a lot sooner than when he's here in June, because I don't know if he knows that we just do this virtually or whatever, but this is going to create a relationship that we're going to cultivate and see where it goes, you know?
Multiple things here. Number one, this is why you don't just absolutely trash somebody right off the jump, right? Right from Jump Street, because there's two sides to every story, right? It's good to hear the other person's side. Just assuming that himself stole it, we could have just been like, okay, he stole it. His name's on it. We're going to go on the podcast and we're going to kill this guy. And we could have done that. And we didn't. By not doing that, it opens up this line of communication. Now, he was nice enough to also to reach out to us and be like, I'm going to listen to the podcast, and did. And I even also had good communication with him after the pod came out. And now when he comes here, we'll probably record prior, like you said, because we'd like to do it probably in the next 2 weeks or so, Grant, yeah, whatever his touring schedule is. And then when he comes here in June, it's like, okay, let's go out and check out his set, or he comes out, checks out a set out here. And now you establish this relationship where it's just another market that, you know, or like if he has like a general market that he plays in where he's at, and you could kind of, you know, share some, you know, whether it be gigs, or if it's not even gigs, if it's just supporting each other through SoundCloud and through Instagram and things like that, and the podcast, like, that's even worth it in the end.
Right. I mean, him sharing our podcast to his fans would be enough for me to be even happy. Like, I don't need anything. Like, he asked me, like, what can I do to make it up? I'm like, dude, you don't have to do anything. Like,
right.
I'm not super upset about it. I just wanted to bring it to your attention and find out what's going on, because it's not cool, number one. And whatever, I think you're right. But I think, like, when he comes to New York, like, we're going to go pop out on the shows, or maybe one of the guys whose edits he took is going to go DJ with him, or maybe we book him at Birch, or I don't know what's going to happen. Like, who knows?
Right. Right. Something could evolve out of this happening. And that's why it's important not to get off on the wrong foot initially. You know, you can have this knee jerk reaction that's very negative, which I think is natural. But then when you take a step back, especially in our industry, if you handle things with a calm, cool, and collected, in a calm, cool, and collected manner, I think more positive can come out of handling things the right way, as opposed to the way you would as a knee-jerk reaction. So another lesson learned.
Yeah, no, I 100% agree. So all's well. And I think, you know, on a greater scale, I think this speaks to, he kind of had to answer me, right? But I think there's a lot of times where we as DJs or producers, or younger DJs and producers, don't necessarily want to reach out to these like bigger artists or producers to either share their music or say what's up or show love. And something that I've realized over the last couple of years is, like, I'll go download a song on one of these record pools and it'll be a reasonably big name person, and I'll literally just shoot them DM, be like, yo, I just downloaded this track off of whatever, it's fire, I'm going to play it in my sets. And that opens up a dialogue, right? So then maybe I'll go create an edit with that track, and then I send it to the producer, and then he's probably going to play it and remember me. And, like, then maybe he puts me on his promo list. And if you do that enough times, you create this huge network of worldwide producers. And it's something that Angelo's done a really good job with. It's something that I've always done, and it's something that I think is really important. So I want to share that also as just like a side to this Funk D conversation.
We're often jaded by maybe the amount of followers somebody had, maybe like what they have in their bio, and looking at like, or comparing, like getting in a pissing contest your social media is like, okay, I only have 5,000 followers compared to this guy has 65,000. But all in the end, we all have started probably in the same place, right? So that person that has that many followers or has played like a Tomorrowland or something like that, like, they started somewhere too. So oftentimes there is a sympathy that comes along with, that comes along with just growth within the business. You know, whether, no matter what level you're at, everybody always remembers where they started out. And I think they're not as big as you might make them up in your head is what I'm saying.
Yeah. And I think a lot of these guys from all over the place are also interested in creating a network of people across the world as well, you know, especially in the United States, especially tri-state New York City.
Yeah.
You know, people want to come to New York. They don't know what our market is, right? Like New York is one of the biggest, most famous cities in the world, right? Everybody's going to want to come to New York. And I think that the allure of New York City also can help you get your foot in the door a little bit. So,
yeah, for sure. I mean, that's definitely an advantage that we have. So
something I'm going to switch up the order on you, Gary, something that, that I had been planning on doing all of last week. And especially, you know, end of the week, Thursday and Friday is always gig prep, music downloading, organizing, stuff like that. All of last week, I was like, I got to organize my music. I got to go through my hip hop. I got to create smaller folders that are more focused, and like, didn't get to do it. All this stuff happened with Funk D. So we're here a week later and I'm still dealing with the same issue of trying to reorganize some music. And I know you just did it and we were talking about how it's helped you so much in your sets.
I really want to emphasize this and emphasize the importance of this as a DJ. Sometimes you kind of forget, well, like when you don't do it for a long while and you just kind of like have these like sets and flows and you're a good enough DJ where you kind of piece things together. You forget that, hey, maybe I should go in and really get into organization. And you can just start with one genre. So I saw that we had been talking about for a long time how our market has really gotten open. And a lot of us have leaned back on EDM because during like vibe dining and things like that, we were getting away with more electronic music because creating energy while people were sitting down was very important. Now we're back to this very, very open format. And I noticed that my hip hop was lacking tremendously, whether it be new hip hop or old hip hop. I just wasn't playing it at the venues that I was playing at, whether I thought it wasn't right for the venue or whatever. As we were getting more feedback from owners and managers saying, hey, there's too much EDM, too much EDM. I was like, let me sit down and really focus on reorganizing new hip hop and then also hip hop from the last 5 to 7 years. And I did that. And I swear I must have had my last three like real sets where I was DJing for, you know, more than 400 people. They were the best sets I might have ever done. And it was just simple. I didn't even download. It was literally songs that were already sitting there on my laptop. And everything was cleaner. I was flowing through tracks quicker. So Ashford on Saturday, I felt like I had a 45 second attention span from everybody. Everybody would go, oh, like big reaction. And then I look back to see like how the dance floor is doing, because the dance floor is kind of on your side. And I'm like, well, nobody's dancing. I was like, it's so strange. Like you're getting this big reaction and then nobody's dancing. So like, all right, let me flip through to another track. And it was just easy to kind of work the whole room because I had redone all of that hip hop stuff. And I tinkered with my Afro pop stuff as well. And so my Latin stuff's always.
Let me jump in before you continue on. What did you do exactly? So let's say you have a big folder, like your hip hop folder, right? And then you have like, all right, 2020 and 2020 on hip hop. Like what did you do exactly? Did you go delete music? Did you create new folders? Did you create subfolders?
Specifically, I have a play now hip hop folder. And then I have other hip hop folders broken down by year. So what I do with my play now, I organized it by BPM. And then like what's the most popular is from that BPM. So how I did it was I got to like a 70 BPM track. I'm like, am I really going to play that? Is it as popular as the other two songs above and below it? Oh, it's not. All right. It's getting taken out. Just make sure it's still in like it's years folder.
Right.
So if I'm ripping through like the set that I'm doing and I'm like, all right, well, this stuff I thought was going to work is not, I can always jump back into one of those other folders and grab like that song if I think that would work.
Right.
You know,
it's hard to explain this because everybody organizes so differently. So it's like, it's good to hear how other people organize their music because maybe it's different from how you're doing it. And maybe it's a good way to reorganize and to change it up and maybe find some songs that you weren't playing a lot of or didn't even realize you had or whatever.
my major thing was to make sure that all of the popular women hip hop tracks were highlighted in pink. So I knew that's it's hot pink. It's a women's hip hop track and it's good. Like it's going to go off. Right.
Yeah.
And then also, so I could jump from 70 to 100 or 100 to 120.
A couple transitions.
In that same genre, just make sure there's a transition in there so I can hit this Cardi track and then hit this Nicki track that's one that's 95 and then hit this other track.
Right.
You know, so that was a big one for me because I know I'm going to play those, but I don't want to get lost in playing them scattered throughout the night. They're more effective packed into sets.
Yeah.
So I made sure of that. And then I made sure like in the seven, I knew I wasn't playing a lot between 70 and 80. So I made sure that that was really clean. And that was stuff that was gonna go off no matter what.
Yeah.
So you kind of have to look into your other sets and kind of self-assess. And once you self-assess in what you're lacking in your set, you can kind of fill in those blank spots, if you will.
A couple things, something Dramos used to always do. And I was, even when we like interviewed him on the show, we talked about it, but he would create a tonight folder for every time he played. And he would have like 10 to 20 songs of just stuff that he 100% wanted to play. Maybe it was the most popular music at the time or whatever it might've been. Just like, if he ever got into a situation where he was like, I don't really know what to play, he had this tonight folder that he could go pull from, or, you know, it hits midnight and you got to start hitting P tracks and he could just go hit that tonight folder. And I always loved that. And I started doing it and I thought it was really effective. And like you said, I think the main reason why, you know, you and I might not have organized too much lately is we've been DJing a long time. I DJ off my brain a lot of the times, which is crazy. I don't even use a folder. I just type stuff in like, all right, I'm hitting this and now I want to go hit this or.
Yeah, that is it, crazy.
Crazy. And like, it's not the most effective way to DJ. I spend too much time in my computer. So having these organized folders where it's clear, where you have all the, you know, the new hot girl tracks together, you could just hit a bunch in a row, or you have the new, you know, 126 electro house tracks in a row, you could just go hit those, you know, their peak hour. And I think it's just effective. It allows for more space for you to connect with your audience, to use the microphone, to actually be watching the reactions to the crowd. I know you and I, a lot of times will like feel reactions, which
we,
you know, experienced DJs, I guess can do more so than the younger guys, but it's not always the most effective way to really see what's happening in the room.
Right.
So I think this is something that's so important and something gets swept under the rug because we're constantly like, oh, I got to go to the record pools and download all the new music. Where sometimes I think you need to be like, all right, I'm going to take 2 weeks, take a pause. I'm not downloading anything new. And I'm going to redo the main folders that I play out of, whatever those might be. And that's kind of where I thought I was going to be. I'm not there yet, but I need to be.
So what I did prior to this is talk to guys that are a little more hip hop centric in our group and younger also. People that are more in tune with kind of what's popular with the younger audience. And then also like people like UFOso, who's just more in tune with hip hop in general. And I was like, well, what's out right now? Like, what are my top 10? Do not give me anything more than 10 tracks. It's like when I get like a 25 track bootleg pack, I'm like, this is too much for me. It's too overwhelming. Like, don't give me like, I know like 10.
You don't download a lot of music.
I don't. Well, anyways, so I went and asked and they're like, there's not a ton out right now. Like, I can't even give you 10 tracks. I'm like, okay, well, I'm going to focus on what I have and what I need to work with based upon what I know the crowds have been reacting to in the hip hop sets that I've been playing. And then also doing like a little bit of research on like what the top 10 Billboard is, let's say.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I approached it. Something about the tonight, forming tonight's crates that, like you said before, that Dramos does.
Yeah.
I was doing that for a while. And then I realized I was putting a bunch of stuff that I wanted to hear in it. And I was like, I would either play it or I would make this, I'd take an hour to make this crate of like 20, 25 tracks and then realize like, holy shit, none of this stuff works here. Like, I'm realizing this is all the stuff that I thought I wanted to play. Yeah. And then the night obviously goes down a different direction. The other thing that I did the last 2 weeks that I haven't done probably since Sona 13, how many years ago, was looking for a night that was successful maybe a year or two ago in my history and dropping that down. And then this way I'm going through tracks maybe that I haven't played in 2 years, but I know that that night was good because I always labeled them like great night or whatever it might've been. I know that sometimes people think that, oh, you can get stuck in a pattern in doing that. But if you go back far enough, you know, you could go find tracks that you had been playing a lot back then, and those become new tracks that you can insert into your sets moving forward.
For two old guys, you know what else is funny? What? We need to reorganize because the stuff to us that was like the throwbacks are like old school. We can't really play a lot of that stuff anymore. And it's like the early 2010 stuff is like the throwbacks to the people who are in the rooms right now. So if you've been DJing a long time, that's another reason why you really need to reorganize, is because you're playing for a different set of people, a different era of people too, you know?
Yeah. I was lucky. Last Saturday at six, I had a group of like 30, they look like 30 something, between 30 and 40 somethings. And I'm like, oh, this is perfect. And just like sat in like old school R&B from like 95 to like, so like 2002 probably.
Yeah.
And like went off like the whole time, you know? And like when you, but it's just looking at people's age in the room,
right?
You know, look how people are dressed.
That was my Liberty Science Center after dark set. Same thing.
all you got to do, and the test is one song. You know which song you're going to pick by, you know, kind of looking at the people in front of you. And if nobody's moving to it, you're like, well, this isn't going to work. I got to move on to whatever the next bag is, and the next trick in the bag, you know?
Yeah.
So,
you know what else is a sign of like the style of music that will 100% work? A lot of the new house and like techier house songs that have been really going off, like Do It To It. There's like a couple new My Humps tech edits.
Yeah.
Like all of those vocals are, you know, 2000, 2010, like Timbaland produced tracks, Promiscuous Girl, you know, all that like pop 2000s music is now being like redone and is really, really popular right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
So use that to your advantage. And then like maybe you can create a transition track from the original to the text song, or create your own edits using some of those vocals. Like you have to use some of this stuff to your advantage.
I've been using the Do It To It from original to.
Yeah, me too.
And that's great because it's not a lot of people know that track. So it sounds like a throwaway track, and then the hook comes and it creates a nice energy in the room. So I really like that.
It surprises people in the room who don't know it, which creates energy.
Right. Exactly. And the other thing, it's interesting that you brought up like the Timbaland produced tracks and the Missy produced tracks, because I've probably subconsciously found myself playing the originals of that now, like being in that 115 area where I feel like sometimes it's no man's land. But now it's not no man's land because there's actually good energy. There's good energy to it. Whereas it sounded played out like 5 years ago, it's got like this new energy to it.
Yeah. I actually love that 115 area because of all those Timbaland tracks and Justin Timberlake and Missy and Sierra. And like, you can warm up a room that 11 to 12 o'clock hour by just playing those songs. And then you're ready to go, you know, like,
yeah, I mean, you got a ton in there. And then if you want to go further back, then you have like Poisons in there and you have Cool It Now and like all that. Michael Jackson, Prince got a ton in there. David Bowie's got a bunch in there. Like there's a ton in that BPM. That's fun. That's good for that opening area.
Yeah.
Where there's still bigger tracks, but they're not like bigger tracks as in like very, very popular that have energy that can kind of set your set off in a really nice way. So. Wow, we had our music discussion very early today.
I know. I told you I switched it on you, but I just had that transition. You know, I had to be a pro out here.
Well, you actually had an experience this past weekend. Talk about like setting the vibe in a room that you had a bouncer have a pretty great quote. I don't know if you have it in front of you.
I wrote it down because I was like, wow, this is for the podcast, literally. You know, so I played a new room last week on Thursday. You know, Lughead, shout to Lughead. He hit me up like last minute. It was like, yo, I need coverage at Common Ground in the city. Can you go do it? all of Common Ground was in Tulum, like hosting parties and having a good time. So like, so I'm like, yeah, of course I'll go rock that party. Like it's a cool room. It's something different. So I did it with little to no understanding of what normally happens there on Thursday. And I just kind of played the room and had fun with it. We had like one big spender table that wanted a certain type of music, but I just was a DJ, you know, and I was having fun. And at the end of the night, one of the bouncers came up to me. He's like, yo, I don't know who you are. You did a great job. And he's like, look at the staff. If you got the staff moving, you're good. And I was thinking about it. I'm like, you're so right. Like, if you can get the staff to be having a good time, you're going to get invited back, because the minute that the DJ and the music is discussed in any kind of a meeting or to a manager, like you're going to be the first person that's brought up because they had a good time. And I deal with this with at Birch with staff hitting me up about DJs they like and DJs that don't like. And guess what? The DJs that the staff likes are 10 times more likely to get another booking. So
absolutely. No, it reminded me of, you know, us saying that when you just got to look around the room and catch a vibe to kind of establish a vibe. And then that quote's kind of perfectly matched into that, because yes, if you get the staff moving, then you know, like if there's a lull, even with your crowd, there's always a fallback to whatever the staff, the genre or the style that the staff really like that you can fall back on. And then this way you're at least keeping them happy. But when they're happy, they're also bringing energy across the bar to the patrons. So, you know, it's a cyclical effect from bartender to the patrons, you know, to you, and everybody's happy at the end of the day. And then even the bouncers, you see the bouncers get into it every once in a while as well.
Right.
So, you know, as long as everybody's having fun, you know, people notice that and it establishes an energy.
This all goes back to playing the room to the best of your abilities, you know, not just packing it in and just playing songs fully through, putting a mix on. Like when you're actually DJing, people are going to know, you know? And like you just said, sharing energy with staff across the bar or bottle girls or whatever it might be, we need to do the same thing as DJs. And when you have like a great stage presence, you're going to have more better nights than slower nights, even if there's not a lot of people in the room. Because people are going to feel that energy. And there's a certain way to create a stage presence. And there's a lot of reasons as to why it's important, right?
Yeah. I mean, one of the most important reasons is just the management and the people that hired you or your boss, like they know that you're there, that you're into what you're doing. That's really the number one thing from a business side. You know, you want to show that. You want to show the manager or whoever it might be that, hey, I'm here to work. Like I'm here, I'm having fun doing it. This is a fun job and I'm expressing that I'm having fun. That's what people want. And patrons want to see the same thing. They don't want to see somebody standing there pressing like, you know, whatever buttons on their laptop and just going through the motions. It's the last thing that anybody wants to see. It's disheartening, number one, for the person who hired you. It's not creating any energy in the room. And the first thought that goes through anybody's mind, especially nowadays, is why can't I just put on Spotify? Right?
What are you here for? Why am I paying you? What's the point?
Yeah. What are you here for? I really want to know. If you're just going to stand here and play the song after the next song, I want to know that too. As somebody who's hiring you, putting you in the room. What the fuck am I hiring you for? You know?
Well, We constantly look happy.
Look like you want to be there and you know, do your job the right way.
We constantly get feedback about the same DJs we book, the ones who always are having a good time, have some sort of personality, maybe use the mic. They get the good feedback and venues want to have those DJs back in. Like Dario, right? Everybody loves Dario. Dario shows up, Dario Valley, huge shout to Dario. He shows up to his gigs. He has a dial-up phone as his headphone. He shows up with a megaphone. He's on the mic. He's screaming at people on the megaphone. He's a sicko, but everybody loves him.
I DJed with him for the first time ever on Halloween. And I know we talked about it, but I got to bring it up again. And I guess I wasn't paying attention, or he's not featuring this on his Instagram. Maybe I'm just kind of falling asleep at the wheel when it comes to pay attention to some of these guys. And he walks in with all this shit. I'm like, what is happening right now? I'm like, I can't even, because it's so out of character for me. Like, that wouldn't be me at all. And I'm like, well, this is fantastic. We're going to take advantage of this. This is going to be a fun time. And that's exactly what we did. And we're just screaming at people in the megaphone, like literally all night. When I woke up the next day, I'm like, probably a little too much. but we were just like having a great time with it. And management and people just, they remember that. It's so memorable.
Yeah.
Cheesy's another one.
Yeah.
Cheesy's so memorable because like he's vibing and dancing so like uncontrollably. It's like one of the greatest, it's the best stage presence I've seen from a local DJ, 100%. And we always have management that says, well, I need more cheesies in the room. Like it's just the energy he's bringing is crazy. And that's multiple managers. That's not one. Assassin's another good one. He's having fun. He's into what he's doing, you know, and mixing songs and creating these groups of songs that really sound good together and creates a lot of energy for people. I've had firsthand seeing these DJs, which I don't get to see all of our guys, but I just want to feature the guys that I'm familiar with.
Yeah. So like some of those things might, like you might be listening to be like, well, I would never do that. And that's okay. You know, everybody's going to have a different stage presence.
Yeah. I certainly don't do that.
Right. Like, you know, use the microphone as a way to connect with your crowd. You know, be really personal with the people that maybe come up to talk to you. And there's a lot of ways to create a presence in the room. And you could do that by, you know, if you're playing hip hop, creating routines or wordplay transitions or things that create a memorable experience people are going to remember. And that goes all into your presence, right? If you're doing a lot of tone play stuff and you can bring something that would allow the customers to see what you're doing, like even better, you're creating this stage presence, this identity of who you are more than just the guy that's mixing two songs together. Yeah. People remember that. Staff remember that. Other DJs remember that. And that's a great way to grow quickly. And it's important.
You know, something that just a random thought, something that I've been, you know, the whole telephone on the head thing.
Yeah.
That like we all should be annoyed at. Like I've been just having as much fun with it as possible. And instead of the patron getting mad if I don't play the song, like by like having some kind of gesture back or joking around with them back, they're less likely to be pissed off. Cause a lot of those people that do that, like I've seen it goes left quick where they're getting mad. So like, try to have fun with those situations too. Like try to have fun with the negative guest and turn it into a positive, cause it'll just make your life easier as the night goes on.
Yeah.
And that also can create a better experience for everybody.
Something else, I think a lot of times as DJs, we kind of like trap ourselves in a box, right? Where, you know, we've seen, you know, the Aokis of the world and certain people take this to an extreme where it's like, all right, are you even DJing at this point? But like jump on your wherever the DJ booth is and get on the mic and shout people out or, you know, there's a million things that you can do to create stage presence that I think the venue and staff would actually really like that you did that no one else has done. And it's not anything out like new and crazy and out of the ordinary. It's just stuff that your local DJ doesn't necessarily do.
We have simple things, just, you know, everybody does confetti cannons. We have simple things that like 66, there's like bubble guns that we're using just to draw attention, just like ridiculous stuff. Like, you know, it doesn't always have to be like this kitschy thing. But, you know, they're just trying to think out of the box sometimes. But also make sure it comes off natural, I think, too.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes if it looks forced, like Dario's isn't forced. That's him. That's his personality. I can't wait to hang out with him tonight at the hockey game because it's going to be ridiculous. Because that's him. Like, that is what his like, character. He's a character, period. You know? And so that works for him. So try to be genuine in whatever you're bringing to the stage with you. That's probably some of the best advice you can give. You know, make sure it doesn't come off too fake.
Yeah. But, I agree with that 100%. Something on my end, that I've been working on is like some of the bigger shows that I've played, whether they're travel shows or Harris Pool. It's like, for me, those are bigger stages where like they have performers. So like I need to do something that stands out and helps set me apart, or at least creates a memorable experience beyond just the DJing thing. And like, that's where I've been really thinking about this, because, you know, I'll watch a Nico Oso do his thing and jump out on the, shut the music off and jump out on the stage in front of 3,000 people at the pool. And like, those are things that I aspire to do that I'm working on. And like, there's always something that you can learn and get better at. Right.
And I
just think that we could all always improve our stage presence. So.
Yeah. That goes back to what we said before. It's just, it's self-assessment, it's self-reflection and understanding what voids need to be filled.
Yeah. All right, guys, we got a devil game to go to tonight. I gotta get moving here.
I looked at the time. I'm like, this went a little longer than I thought. So this is pretty good.
Yeah. All right, guys. So we appreciate you listening. We'll check you next week. And
well real quick, Kareem, where are you at this weekend?
Oh, that's right. Sorry. I'm jumping the gun here.
he's really trying to get out of here.
All right. Thursday night, I'm at Tally Ho Hoboken. Friday, I am back at 46 Lounge in Totoa, which I have not played in. I couldn't even tell you the last time.
Probably 2019 at some point.
Yeah, probably. The Ashford Saturday night, and then Wicked Wolf for Sunday Funday football, which is going to be a shit show.
Always is. I tried to get in last week and it did not work. No shout out to Slav on that one.
Fuck you, Slav.
Fuck you, Slav. Right, exactly. All right, Thursday, I am at Fat Taco, one of our home spots right below the office here. Friday, 6:26. We'll have drag shows and all that good stuff on Friday. Saturday afternoon, drag brunch back at 6:26. Saturday night, 13th Step in New York City. Haven't played there yet, so that should be fun. And then Sunday at the Shepherd, Uptown Hoboken for football. So that should be a good time. And then I get to go home on Monday. Thank God.
Gotta go home. Yeah, I feel like the snowbird lifestyle, you know, doesn't necessarily mean staying in New Jersey for 3 weeks in January. Probably not the smartest move there.
I've been here five out of the last 6 weeks, which is crazy. So get me out of here.
All right, guys. Thanks for listening to this episode of The Get Down. My name's Kareem.
Gary W.
Peace.
Peace.